We're lucky enough today to have four speakers. We have Damian, Burke, who works for IFS at the University of Newcastle. We have Jonathan Russel from Hansen, Yuncken, Anthony Furniss from EJE, Ethan Clark from ABP. So thanks, guys, for giving up your time to come in today. And I'll hand over to Damian just to do the overview and the introduction.
Great. Thanks, Mark. And thanks for the opportunity as well. It's great that you show some interest, obviously a fairly significant project for the university. And collectively and part of the team, we're all very happy to share, I guess, the excitement that's coming up and that you can see now developing through the new building in town. So just a little touch more on the introductions. As Mark said, my name's Damian Burke. I work for Infrastructure and Facility Services at the university. My role on the project is project director. So what I'll take you through today is an overview of what we call the project essentials, which is a bit of an overview on the brief. Benefits of new space. Why is the actual university, why have we gone ahead? Why have we embarked on such a significant project? Some of the key features that we included within the brief, which we've asked our design team to respond to. We'll work through some of the delivery methodology that the university ended up adopting, some of the process behind that. We'll talk just generally about the team structure, and there's a couple of quite a few interesting elements from a procurement point of view, but we'll just hone in quickly on the principal contract tender. Ethan will then come and talk about some of the significant early works that we had to do to prepare the site, which was the mine rectification works. We'll then walk through a design overview with Anthony and Jono. We'll talk about the complexities in regards to the construction and bring us right up to speed of where we are today. Project essentials. We have a $95 million project. $30 million of that is from our federal government through a funding agreement. $25 million was committed from the state government. And the university, I guess a significant contribution there, of $40 million as well. That does comprise of the early works, which we'll hear a lot more about. The new build, which you're seeing now come into town. But also, if you're not realising, there's also a very significant integration with University House. The old Nesca House, which is actually a university facility, and again a commitment to that as an asset for the university. We've looked to integrate our new development in with our old, being a state significant heritage building as well. So on day one, we'll have more than 3,500 students, and we'll have the capacity to build up to about 4,500 students in the actual building in itself. The site footprint is just short of 4,000 square metres. What we're building has a GFA of 14,000 square metres, and we've pretty much built right up to our height limit of 45 metres. So this is probably a good opportunity to show you our fly-through of the building, and I'll let you absorb this, and it might make a context of the overall design coming up a little bit more understanding. Yeah, it's actually been a little while since I've watched the fly-through myself, and can see some of the complexities that Jono will be talking about later in regards to the construction. Still to this day, obviously, we watch that and we see it coming together, and it's quite exciting for us, particularly if I haven't seen that for a little while. Now, around about the benefits that the university, why have we embarked on such a project? A big part of that is you, is the students. Needing to provide or wanting to provide a world-class student experience. Encourage that collaboration. You might have seen some of those teaching spaces in the fly-through, providing that group work-based learning. Provision of students where you actually want to occupy. We want you to come into this building and we want you to stay. We want you to enjoy the amenity. Technology-enabled teaching modes. We're using the current and emerging technologies to support your teaching, or the teaching experience and the learning experience. And also, moving into the city provides a location that potentially some students who want to work and study will have that opportunity at in a closer proximity. The other big element, and this project has been a catalyst around the revitalisation of Newcastle, is what this impact will have on the community. We're expecting, with over 3,500 students and 300 odd staff on day one, that will inject a lot more life into the CBD, which will be then driving the investment in response to that. We've already seen some of the businesses around the neighbourhood benefiting from new space, probably some of the takeaway shops particularly around with the construction workers. But we also expect this type of world-class facility to also drive more diversity in the students that come to learn with the University of Newcastle. We obviously have, with those numbers, we have a flow on spending. You stay in the city, you buy from the shops, the local businesses. And also with numbers comes increased safety and security. With this facility is looking potentially at to run 24/7 in some times, so I guess security in numbers. The key features we've talked a little bit about in the brief, but it needed to be a world-class facility. That was probably number one point. It's number one here. We wanted to interconnected academic environment. We needed to provide this dynamic type learning hub, again, somewhere where we'd want the students to come and to stay, feel like they're in a dynamic space. In support of that, we needed a lot of open areas, a lot of learning space where you can just do your informal learning. The next generation learning experience was around that change in pedagogy, the learning styles that will be driven through new space and similar type environments. Technology rich, and that's not technology just to support the teaching, but it was also technology throughout the building. To be very connected within this facility. I touched a little bit on the learning environments. They needed to be flexible and adaptable. A little bit different to this type of style of teaching, more didactic style, but that flexibility to change from course to course. And that's feeding into those non-traditional type approaches. And again, touching on, probably on the first point, it's needed to be an iconic building for Newcastle, something that everybody knew this building would be the University of Newcastle. So I'll go quickly through how we actually developed the project, the team structure and the methodology. And this is very much early in the project. I was just talking before, I think I've been on the project for 3 years now. So these conversations happened, 3 years ago when we set up the actual project. We looked through a procurement selection workshop where we reviewed all the available contracting options. That you may or may not be aware of, but through those, we identified some key issues that we needed to, resolve through our procurement delivery. Some of those was critical that we maintain cost control. We needed to avoid the adversarial relationships, and we know from experience that takes time and money. So we needed to manage that risk. We wanted to stay within our capability and availability, and that's a lot to do with how we are resourced internally at the university. We wanted to ensure that we had design control and flexibility. With such a significant and catalyst project, we wanted to make sure we had control on the design to a point where we were comfortable in handing it over. We wanted to deliver on time. Sounds very simple. We wanted to potentially manage our reputational risk as well throughout there. So a lot of that meant that we needed to control this design to a certain point where we were comfortable. So what resulted out of that assessment process, and we had some criteria and a matrix completed. It was a design, development and construct, maintaining an option to novate our design team to the contractor. And the benefits of that model was that we could control the design excellence. We designed up to around about 80% before we engaged with Hansen Yuncken being the successful contractor. We also had contractor availability for buildability input. We did that through early tender involvement through the procurement process. We're able to have contractors at the table to talk about potential innovations in design, some of those innovations that potentially you don't get if we design this incomplete. And we obviously, with the model, we would leave it up to the builder to finish the design. And that's to obviously secure those buildability issues. And I think with a completely designed project, when you hand that over, inevitably there becomes coordination issues that the builder is resolving along the way, but us as the client or the principal end up paying for as well. One critical thing here, and it was around the whole project team, was to focus on this relationship-based model. And again, we talked about the risk of having poor relationships within delivery. We couldn't afford that. We were on a pretty tight time frame. We needed to work together. So, and I'm very happy 3 years on that we've actually achieved that through the team. The non-adversarial working conditions goes hand in hand with the relationships. So quickly around the team structure, we have APP, which is sitting in the middle, is our project managers. Again, looking at our resource availabilities internally at the university, we needed to outsource the day-to-day project management. So APP was successful in that instance. We have a cost manager that sits out the side. We then, below APP, we have our principal design consultant, which EJE are a critical part of. Underneath that, you'll have your sub-consultants that will answer into that team. We have other consultants, which was really early about the site assessments and early works packages that Ethan will talk about as well. And our contractors under here was around that mine rectification works and obviously our major works, which is in regards to the new space and the integration of University House as well. So you can see that we had some fairly major sort of external and internal stakeholders to manage throughout the process. The tender process, I'll go through quickly. There was basically an expression of interest. We went out to the market and received responses from capable builders. It was a way of shortlisting the market. From there, and this, I guess the unique thing about this is that we were doing this concurrent with designing. So after concept design, we actually had something that we could show the market of this is our intention, this is what we'll actually be wanting to construct. Following our approval of our schematic design, we went out for a request for proposal, which is a little bit more detailed process where we get some more information from our shortlist and we evaluate that to come down to a final number. So where it's the request for tender. And it was at the request for tender time where we were actually looking at our lump sum pricing from the market. Critical to that process was the early tender involvement, and that happened through all those stages after the expression of interest. And that was, again, designed to engage with our market, with our shortlist, to try and bring in the knowledge of the building, look at the innovations that were potential available throughout the rest of the design. So those benefits, we talked about the shortlist, occurs in parallel with the design development. So we didn't waste any time in regards to the program waiting for our design to be finished. It was obviously an equitable market selection. There was ability to respond to the expression of interest. We ended up with a small pool of quality suppliers for our RFT. So we didn't want to waste too much of the time of the market. It's an incredible investment that our contractors make into this process as well. And obviously the opportunity for the contractor-led innovations through our early and tender involvement. So just closing out on there, we reassessed throughout that contract development around our DD&C model. And the big thing for us was around having a delineation on who was responsible for design. So we decided that we moved to a completely design and construct contract where obviously Hansen Yuncken was successful in that following the evaluations that we did. Obviously fairly rigorous evaluation process for a contract this size, which included that innovation review which we're trying to extract from the process. So following negotiations, our best and final offer, we awarded the contract to Hansen Yuncken, but I guess the significance of the project that required to go through the Vice Chancellor and the University Council in order to get that contract awarded. And what was also, I talked earlier about the option to novate our design team. We actually took that option and we developed a novation deed where Lyons and EJE actually then got novated, or pretty much contractually moved over underneath the builder for the design finalisation. And that decision was only made after assessing, I guess, the capability and capacity that our principal design consultants had. But also it was a real reasonable level of comfort that model could work. And I think that was one smart thing that we actually did throughout the whole process, is we didn't rush in to our predetermined delivery model when we were assessing the contract award. So that's about it for me. I think you get to look at the pretty pictures and it's coming up as well, which is a little bit easier to talk to. So I think I'll hand over to Ethan to start talking about the mine rectification. And thank you very much for your time for us.
Thanks, Damien. So APP was awarded the project management of the New Space project in late 2013, and I've been on the project since then. So as Damien said, I'm a project director with APP. My background, when I finished my engineering degree in the mid-90s, I went and worked as a structural engineer for 10 years and then returned to Newcastle and joined APP and moved into project management. So in addition to getting our designers on board at the end of 2013, we also had a number of site issues that we needed to move pretty quickly on, one of which was mine rectification. So I'll just sort of give you an outline of rectification, what it means for building in Newcastle, and the works that we did. So we'll run through the mine subsidence issue, the assessment that we did, the solution, which was drilling and grouting, number of issues and risks, and then some of the implications for the structural design once you have completed the mine rectification works. So underneath Newcastle CBD, we have four coal seams, being the Nobbies, Dudley, Yard and Borehole. And the New Space project coal seams, there they are, and the depths and the thicknesses. So essentially, Nobbies is very close to the surface. It sort of comes and goes. It's unmined and it's very weathered. The Dudley seam is around 23 to 24 metres underground. Then the Yard and the Key seam, which is 7 metres thick, is the borehole seam. And that has been mined pretty much everywhere underneath Newcastle, out to sea, under the harbour. Now, when you go and commence your discussions with the Mine Subsidence Board, you'll receive, well, get some early indications of where the mine workings are, and they'll give you a map like this. Now, essentially, the red to the south, you can see Hunter Street there, those red jaggedy lines, that's the borehole seam, mine workings. Everywhere south of that has been mined, and I'll show you another slide next that shows the board and pillar mine workings. Underneath Hunter Street, it hasn't been mined. And then to the north of Hunter Street, you can see areas that have been mined and then other areas that haven't. And the pink line is actually the Dudley seam. Now, there's no maps for where it's been mined, but that's, I guess, the Mine Subsidence Board's general understanding of the mine workings there. So coal mining of the seam was undertaken using board and pillar. So essentially they'll cut a board and leave a pillar behind that remains today and supports the overburden. The widths were around 5 to 6 metres wide and the pillars 9 to 12 metres. You can see the diagram there. So they cut in various layers. Sometimes they would have cut the full depth of the coal seam. Other times they just did one or two cuts, and the depth of the remaining opening might be 2 to 3 metres. And then post-mining and over time, the roof has typically collapsed and you'll get a whole bunch of rubble and mud and silt in the mine workings, and they are flooded, so they're completely full of fresh water as it happens. Now, there's a couple of different types of subsidence that are a risk. For the upper workings, if they have been mined, pothole subsidence is where movements of the ground surface have occurred over shallow workings, and you'll get a localised depression or a pothole. And you might have read in the media in Lambton, you know, houses need to be bought by the Mine Subsidence Board after they've suffered some subsidence. That is typically pothole subsidence. Now, the next type of subsidence is what's called progressive collapse, and that is the type of subsidence that would be an issue for new space. And essentially, it is like a domino or a pillar run where one pillar would degrade over time. And I mean, we're already talking about mine workings that have been done 100 years ago, and the pillars do degrade, and there's been instances of pillar runs in the UK after sort of 200 years worth of mine workings that were done 200 years ago. So it does happen. Now, a little bit about, I guess, history of borehole seam instability in Newcastle. So there has been an instance of a pillar run in Newcastle. The first creep occurred in 1906 and covered an area south of Ordnance Street. So that's up underneath King Edward Park, if you're familiar with King Edward Park. And there was subsidence in the range of 400 to 800 millimetres. There was then a second creep in 1907 to the north of Ordnance Street and up to the cathedral, which also ranged subsidence from 200 to 700 millimetres. And then a third creep in 1908, which there wasn't much pronounced surface subsidence, but it basically ran down the hill to the mall. And now, there was a Royal Commission that was undertaken in 1908 to investigate this. Essentially, what was happening is that there wasn't enough coal being left in the ground such that the pillars were not strong enough to support the overburden. So I've just shown you there the areas. So underneath King Edward Park here at the bottom of the image is the first creep, then down the cathedral that you can see there, and also the mall. Moving on to assessment. So Coffey Geotechnics were our geotechnical and mine rectification consultant for New Space. They undertook a finite element analysis of various grouting options, and I'll show you those next. So essentially what they do is they build a model which is about a city block, and it will include all of the overburden ground, I guess, parameters along with the board and pillar mine workings, and then they'll essentially run an analysis where they will weaken the parameters of the coal pillars until there's a collapse, until the model has triggered a collapse, and they can see where there is weakness and where a pillar run could first start, and then that will guide the grouting solution. So you can see Hunter Street and Auckland Street there. You can see our site on the corner, and you can see the grouting solution that we ended up with. Now, That grouting solution is essentially targeting those square pillars that you see within the grout. So that was our weak point. They were the pillars that failed first during the finite element analysis. The red dots are the boreholes that were planned to be drilled down, and we would fill from those. Now, it's obviously apparent that we're not grouting under our site. We're grouting under Auckland Street, which was our, I guess, source of weakness close to the site. You can also see, so this is all of the rectangular, they're the boards, that's the coal that has been left, and the pillars, or mined coal. And you can see that any pillar run, I guess, will come towards the project from the southeast in a domino fashion. So this is the type of analysis or output that Coffee generated from their finite element analysis model, and it's essentially showing surface displacements following grouting. Now you can see red essentially is zero displacement, and then we've got a lighter shade of red into orange, 7.5 to the minus 2, so that's 75 millimetres of displacement at the surface during a collapse with the grouting solution, and then the last one being the yellow, so you can see the corner of our site in the yellow, 100 millimetres. Now that then guides our requirements for design of the structure. So in the event of a mine subsidence, progressive collapse, we're still going to have to deal with tilt, strain, surface displacement at the site, and our structure needs to be able to accommodate those structural loads. We moved into, once we'd sort of established our grouting solution, and we're in the process of getting that approved by the Mines Subsidence Board, we also went out to tender to a number of capable contractors. We used what's called GC21 contract, which is a state government contract typically used for state government projects and by the university. And the tender was awarded to Bulk Fly Ash Grout middle of 2014. They also did the mine rectification of the Newcastle Courthouse project for me. So I had some experience with this contractor and knew their strengths and weaknesses. So the process in terms of the grouting, I mean, drilling is the first thing you need to do. The mine workings are not exact, or the maps of the mine workings are not exact, so you need to essentially take your best guess and put down a borehole, and then you'll run a camera and a sonar down there and determine if you're lucky enough to have hit void. You'll then put a sonar down the hole, determine where exactly in the board you have hit, and then you can readjust your map from there and adjust the next borehole. Now the grout, it's a very, very weak material. About 1 MPa is what it comes up to at 90 days. It's simply water, fly ash and cement in about a 6 to 12% ratio, depending on the strength that you need and also the thickness of the grout that you're trying to achieve. So it's a little bit of a balance. We're pumping down quite a cheap material, but you also don't want to waste it. So it's not like concrete that'll come out of a batch plant where it's quite thick and it won't run away. This is essentially just a grey water that you pump down. Fly ash, as most of you will know, is just a byproduct from the power plants. Now, depending on the type of coal that they're burning, there'll be different parameters that will be developed in terms of the strength of the grout and how much water it needs. So this is how we laid out the site. Essentially, there's a batch plan. I'll have a number of silos for fly ash and cement. You'll have semi-trailers delivering up to maybe half a dozen loads per day. So there's significant large truck movements that need to come into site, unload, and then you're also pumping all day. You'll typically pump around 100 cubic metres per day, and that'll sort of set up overnight. Some of the issues and risks, grout strength is obviously one. The Mine Subsidence Board have approved a solution that will require a 1 MPa strength. Now, the less cement that you put in, obviously, the cheaper the solution is going to be for the client. So you're always, I guess, pushing the limits in terms of trying to just meet that 1 MPa at 90 days. The mine water is what we use, so it's essentially fresh water, slightly brackish, and it's mixed and then put down the holes, infill grouting beyond the extent. So we're dealing with quite a liquid material that really does flow. So the client is paying for grout on a per cubic metre basis, so you need to limit as best possible the amount of grout that's been pumped in, cost estimate and risk. So as I sort of touched on a little bit earlier, in developing up the structural design, the Mine Subsidence Board obviously recognises that you've done grouting, but in the event of mine subsidence event, there will be residual subsidence at the site. So they placed a design requirement on us to accommodate 100 millimetres of vertical subsidence, strains of plus or minus 2 millimetres, and tilts of 2 millimetres per metre. They also asked us to have the structural design, which was done by Oricon, peer reviewed. So the peer reviewer was Northrop in this instance, and then the foundations and underground structures designed for the above parameters and also be isolated from the ground movements. So this is the foundation layout for new space, and I'll just describe it to you. So this central large box with all of the piles underneath it, that's our lift core. That, I think it's about a metre and a half thick raft slab lands on those piles, which were either 600 or 750 diameter. That's essentially fixed. Now those piles go down, I think, 10 metres to bedrock, which is sandstone. And then what we've done is we've got all the other piles surrounding with pile caps, and they're linked by grade beams. So those pile caps are essentially isolated with a rubber bearing pad from the pile underneath. Now, in the event of a subsidence, remembering we're needing to deal with strains of 2 millimetres per metre. So from the core out to the far corner, that might be 30 metres or something like that. So we're dealing with ground movements in the order of 60 millimetres. Now, if the foundations are not isolated, from those movements, then incredible forces will need to be accommodated by the structure. So you can't physically design for those forces. So what we do is the columns and the structure above is tied back to the core and isolated from the ground movements. Now, each one of those grade beams has styrofoam on each side of it, and that allows the movement in the event of, I guess, a ground movement. And this is what the pile cap detail looks like. So we've got our piles underneath. There's a large pile cap there. You can see the hashed, it's been called out as a bearing pad. That's just, a thick rubber bearing pad. We've then got our secondary pile cap on top with our column landing on it, and the tie beams that tie it all together back to our lift core structure. So that's essentially that. Grouting was finished in about 5 months. We pumped in 5,000 cubic metres of grout, which was essentially in line with our original estimate. We delivered for, I think it was, total cost was about $1.2 million, which was a good result. That's what we'd budgeted for. And we ran all of this works concurrent to the design. So the Lions EJE team were developing up the design during 2014, and we completed works in October. So that's it for me. I'll hand over to Anthony to run you through the design.
Okay, as Damien said, we've been working on this project for some 3 years. At the core to the project has been the collaboration between a whole series of people. Whilst I'm standing out in front representing the design team's probably some 20 people in the lead up to developing the concept design, which was submitted as part of our competition entry. So it's ironic that we're designing spaces for collaboration to occur between students, because in fact it does really occur in the real world, and it's the result of such collaborations are what we're going to show you today. Rather than going into too much detail, a lot of you will visit the building, you'll walk through the building, you'll see how the building's laid out, but what you won't see is probably the thinking behind the way the building looks, and some of the more abstract thinking behind the building. So that's what I'll move through reasonably quickly today. As I said, very much a collaboration. During the competition, we had people working on different parts of the project. We had people working on the brief, people working on analysing the site and the context, people looking at research into teaching and learning spaces, and as well as academic workspace. All of it comes through and gets brought into the design. This university building is very different to those that we've got on campus. As much around where it is, it's a very different context. We're not in a bushland campus like you have out here. We're very much in an urban setting. So we got down and dirty to understand what the context of our site was. We're actually in the middle bubble of this diagram, which shows three bubbles. That being the civic. So we're in amongst a whole lot of public buildings. The group were interested to know the history of the site dating back pre-European history. We're lucky enough that we've got a division in EJE that is looking at heritage of Newcastle every year and trying to understand from paintings that were done during colonial time to understand the potential uses for areas based on these particular paintings. You can see our site in yellow. What this diagram shows is a series of those paintings and where we believe those paintings were painted from. One of those in particular, very close to our site, was that of a corroboree with Nobby's headland in the background. So we're interested to understand the significance of the site and what was important to the importance of the site dating pre-European. So what we wanted to do was maintain a lot of those views that were evident in those early paintings, including those of Nobby's and also the Hunter River. As I said, we're located in a catalogue of public buildings. All of these buildings in red are those that any one of us can go and visit during those hours of operation, whether they be libraries, galleries, museums, and we're very much in the heart of those buildings. Immediately adjacent to our site, we've got a series of buildings with significant European history. We've got the City Hall, we've got the Civic Theatre, and we've got Nesca House, which is now University House. These three buildings are very much buildings that represent the design thinking of those times. So whilst you've got, you're probably spanning three decades with these three buildings, and each of them, as I said, represents the design thinking around that time. For instance, Town Hall Clock, or the clock on Town Hall, the architect was very much, at that time, the thinking was toward Egypt because Tutankhamun was being uncovered and there was a lot of interest in Egyptian history. So the Town Hall Clock bears a resemblance to a lighthouse in Alexandria. You've got Soderstein's University House, or sorry, Nesca House, which was much to do around Art Deco. But all of these three buildings are three buildings in the round. They don't only face, or they don't only relate to one particular facade. They are very much seen in the round. You can walk all the way around them. And so we looked at the new building as being one that, A, represented the design thinking of the time, so that in years to come, when they looked at this catalogue of buildings, they could isolate them each against the time that they were built. But also we saw our building as a building in the round as well. The site is also a gateway site to the precinct. You've got recently completed courthouse, which is the gateway from the east, and from the west is our site. And we looked at all the different approaches to the site to then understand the design of the ground floor plane, to work out where we were going to enter the building, how many entries we were going to have. We looked at the green space around and how we could contribute to it if we could. We've got Civic Theatre, Civic Park, and we've also got Christie Park. I mean, at the moment, Christie Park is not a very activated park, and it's mainly to do with the buildings that are currently adjacent. They don't really open to that that area of the city. And what we were looking at was how could we, with the new building and the work that we were doing to University House, start to activate some of those green spaces. This is a picture that was taken on the first day the design team walked onto the site. The buildings that were previously on that site were knocked down, and what it revealed was Town Hall Clock was staring us right in the face, and it became a driving factor behind the design. With those buildings previously on that site from Hunter Street, you couldn't see Town Hall Clock from Hunter Street. We looked at the surrounding buildings, University House, and the materials that we used, the aluminium, the sandstone, and how we could relate to those materials. We also looked at some of the buildings that were previously on Hunter Street and how those buildings related to Hunter Street. And what was significant were the upper level verandas. Drilling into the analysis of the actual site itself and how we laid out the footprints, we looked at setbacks to do with the development control plan of the Newcastle City Council. We lined ourselves up with University House. We created a laneway through between University House and the site, and a laneway creation that links Wheeler Place with Auckland Street. We then, as I said, we had another team looking at the brief and dissecting the accommodation and how we were going to lay out all of these spaces over a number of floors. We had several options. Option one, for example, was to go to the maximum height limit. Option four, for example, was to bring everything down to a lower scale. In the end, we decided to go to the maximum height limit. We worked on a hybrid accommodation where we were wanting to locate academic workspace and teaching space on every level throughout the building. The lower three levels, of course, would be more intense and try and get the majority of the teaching space lower to the street. This then related to how we were going to map out our footprint on the site. This shows option four, for example, a reasonably low height building. And this shows the taller building, which is the one we went forward with. And what that meant in terms of the site was we didn't have to use all of the site, and we could actually hive off some of the site to contribute to additional green space. Problem with that is it provided a hole in Hunter Street, which we wanted to fill. So we pushed part of the building along Hunter Street to create less of a hole, still have an opening there to enable access through onto the site and through to Christie Park, but we still wanted to relate to Hunter Street. Similarly on Christie Place, we wanted the building to relate to Christie Place. We wanted you to be able to see it from the southern approach as you move out of Cooks Hill across Civic Park toward the site. And as I touched on, the Town Hall clock, we wanted to maintain that view for perpetuity. Once those buildings were knocked down and that clock stood in front of us, we didn't want to then put up a building which hid it from Hunter Street again. And the net result was we contributed to green space. We connected Christie Place to the south, through onto our site, through onto Hunter Street, and created a civic green, campus green. What this also enabled us to do was to enable activation of all the surrounding buildings onto those spaces. It was important that although we were going to a maximum height limit, we still wanted to appeal to the and relate to the buildings that were directly adjacent. We've got four-storey university house directly adjacent to us, so we wanted a portion of our building to line up with not only the setback that we'd reflected, but also the height of those two structures. Similarly, on Hunter Street, we've got Civic Theatre. And again, we wanted to break down the building at the street to relate to those two buildings. Looking at the design above the street, now that we'd settled on what we were doing at the ground plane, again, we could have just extracted a rectangular form above those levels on the street. But what we wanted to do was draw people's attention to that view toward Nobby's. If you couldn't see it from Hunter Street, we wanted you to be able to look up at the building and sort of wonder why the building was bending and twisting in that particular direction, as well as provide views for those up at those higher levels in the building toward Nobby's. That's a picture that was taken just after the mega trusses were installed, just to make sure we did align with it. We were a bit worried. But what we also did is we twisted the building again so that it drew you to Town Hall clock as well. So not only were we doing that at street level by creating that gap, but we were also twisting the building at that higher level. And that's the view from the urban room that is located up on those higher levels at Town Hall clock. What that started to develop was a three-dimensional thinking of how the building would look, and these are very early conceptual models that we drew up, showing the view along Hunter Street and the way that the building at the upper level twists and turns and throws itself toward Nobby's. The alignment with those surrounding buildings. One of the final renders through to a photo I took just yesterday of where we're up to show that we are still on track with that original global thinking from 2013 toward where we are now and the great job that Jono and his team are doing.
Cool. Afternoon, everyone. Thanks for making the time and also giving me opportunity. I'm Jono. I'm the project manager for Hansen Yuncken, responsible for the build of this lovely building. Obviously, this is a great session for me just to whinge and complain about how hard it is to build the bloody thing. But we've called it complexities of the build.
So I guess the first thing I want to say is that, you know, as has been mentioned earlier, it really is a state-of-the-art facility. This is a pretty incredible building, which the university is providing in terms of the spaces that are available in there and the technology that's going into those spaces as well. It's really at the forefront of educational facilities right throughout Australia. It is a pretty impressive facility, which hopefully you'll get some good exposure to once it's open. It's certainly come a long way from when I was here at university not so long ago, and we were getting excited about being in Red Square. So I guess it is an incredibly challenging project. We'll talk about some of those challenges. It's in quite a short time period for us from construction. We've only been on the project from June last year, so sort of, you know, 20-odd month build. It's pretty tight when you see the significant structure and finishes and facade that's going on to the building. And just as Anthony touched on, I think really the key for us in terms of what makes that possible is really about relationships. You know, I'm a small cog in a big wheel at Hansen Yuncken for our project team, where we've got a lot of ex-university graduates actually, but also with the other guys that we work with as well, the consultant team, which we work really closely with, our ongoing relationship with APP here in Newcastle, and especially our relationship with the University of Newcastle. We greatly value that, and it's those relationships that have obviously enabled this incredible beast to come together. So, complexities of the build. Firstly, I just wanted to touch on the importance of a safety culture. It's a massive thing at Hansen Yuncken. Safety is a huge part of the way that we do business, and that's what I'll try to talk about there by saying that safety culture in construction is integral, but also needs to be integrated. It needs to be part of the way that you do business. Safety is not something that gets tacked on at the side or at the end when you're building a project. It's there from conception. It's there when you're talking with the design team about how they're going to build. The sessions that we've had with Anthony, with Damian and with Ethan, with the university, APP, talking about, okay, this is what you've designed. How are we going to safely build what you've designed? When you designed it, did you have in mind how it was going to be safely built? Did you have in mind how it was going to be safely operated? You've got a plant room up on the roof. There's roof access up on top. Have you thought about how you're going to be able to get up onto that roof? You've got these dirty great big X columns supporting the knobby structure. Have you thought about how we're going to safely lift those into place? We've had over 1,000 workers come through the construction site already, and every one of those workers has gone home safely, and that's a big part of that integration and the fact that safety is integral to every aspect of what we do, from design through to delivery. And that's just what I talked about there in terms of our people, the systems that we've implemented, and our work with our stakeholders as well. Okay, so my whinge. We'll talk about the substructure and some of the challenges in the ground, and some of you probably know for Newcastle construction, generally there are significant issues for us in ground, particularly with mine subsidence, as Ethan spoke to us about. We'll talk about the structure and a couple of processes that we implemented for how we completed the concrete core, and also how some challenges around those X columns that we spoke about, and then also talking about the facade and some of the massive challenges of this pretty insane facade that we have on the building. So in terms of the substructure, one of the major challenges is the water table in Newcastle CBD. So the water table, well, our site at New Space is about an RL of 2.5 or 2.6. So if you know what that means, roughly we're a couple of metres above the water table, but obviously the water table in Newcastle's tidal as well, so depending on the tide, it's sort of around that 2 metre mark. So for us, we had quite a bit of in-ground structure. As Ethan mentioned, we had board piers going down some 12 to 15 metres. We also had those significant pile caps, which we'll have a look at in a second, and also our main core raft, which you can see in the image there. So you can see we've opened up our core raft there, and we've already got water on the surface of that sort of that low-level excavation. So what we needed to implement was a series of spear points. You can see the black line that runs around the outside of the core, and then you've got the little orange pump sitting next to it. That's basically our dewatering facility. So those spears are going down into the ground. The pump's sucking up through those spears to remove that water. It's then sending it over to that flocking station, which you see sitting up the back next to our substation. And that's where we remove the turbidity or the dirt in the water, and do some testing on it before we pump it back into the stormwater system. So that was a key challenge for us. It then enabled us to move forward with excavation around the core raft and also complete our waterproofing and formwork that was required around the core, which you see in the images there, and eventually place concrete to the core before we were able to remove those spears. So just talking generally then about the substructure and some of our challenges in the ground. We had roughly 100 piles to be drilled. There was a couple of options for us around how those piles would be drilled. You can see there we're working at a surface level about RL 2.6. The couple of options we had some submissions of some push piles, which had been used previously in Newcastle, not too successfully. And the option that we actually went for was for a CFA board pile. There's a few advantages around that system. It's basically sort of self-forming, so you drill and you pour the concrete as the rig is removed from that excavation. It does produce a bit of extra spoil. And the other challenge that we had, which it might come up in some of these images, so here's the piling rig establishing here once we've levelled up the platform for him, drilling the rig there. What you do need to do with a CFA pile is you need to bring it up to the surface that you're working at. So we actually needed our CFA piles to stop about 2 or 3 metres down from the working level that we're on, because that's the underside of our pile cap. It wasn't possible to be able to make safe access for each one of those pile locations, given we've got 100 piles across the site. So what we actually had to do was drill the piles into position and then excavate around them, and actually we had a couple of different methods. We had a crushing machine, and we also had some labourers on the jackhammer as well, removing the top of those piers. So this is setting up around the core, starting to excavate the core, and you can see there that, I don't know if you can see it, but the little yellow thing there, that's actually the core muncher or crusher, and that's what we use for removing the top of the core. Then we also had to open up the individual areas where we were establishing these pile caps. That was done using shoring boxes because it's a pretty sandy site, so the soil doesn't have great structural integrity. And also there's not a lot of room to be able to bench and batter either. So those shoring boxes were pretty important with our methodology in the ground. So obviously that was a pretty challenging process, and one that really drew out the amount of work that we had to do in ground, because we couldn't open up large areas at any one time. We were working in an isolated area. We were opening up, putting the shore box in, placing the pile cap on top of the pile, backfilling across, and then coming through with our web of tie beams, which I don't know if you noticed from Ethan's drawing there, but basically that whole site, anywhere where there's structure, is covered with that web of tie beam, which you'll probably pick up in a couple of images there. There you can see in the top left there, we've started to form up. That's a series of tie beams up through there, sitting on top of the pile caps, which is also where the rubber bearing pads are sitting on top there. We also had ground strain to accommodate for, because as part of the mine subsidence works, as Ethan mentioned, there was potential for the ground to move 1.7 millimetres per metre, which doesn't sound like much, but across the full length of our site, you're getting up around sort of 80 millimetres of movement through the ground. So each one of those tie beams also had to be encapsulated in polystyrene to be able to allow for that potential movement in the ground. Once we started to get out of the ground, we got our core poured. We established the shutters for the concrete core. Now, this was a key decision for us on the project. We have a few options for how we could potentially have poured that concrete core. The key challenge for us was maintaining what it was a really tight program for us through the structure. So we made a decision to implement a jump form system. The way the jump form system works is these panels come in, we prep up to pour our first level of core walls. Once we get our first level of core walls poured, so that's what that scaffold access is providing there for us to be able to pour those walls from on top. Once we've poured that first level of walls, there's a structural steel system, which is part of the jump form. So over 2,000 bolted connections on this bad boy, it comes in and sits on top and basically supports those wall frames from above. Now, the way the process works is you establish your shutters. So that's what you can see there, is the shutters which are actually forming the walls. You've then got a frame system and your platform decks that sit over the top, and then you've got some screens which come around and basically hide the whole thing. So what that enables us to do is, you can see there, the grey area is pretty well our concrete core. What we wanted to do is we wanted to get our concrete core up as quickly as we could to get it out of the way of our main pour decks. So when we were trying to pour our decks, we didn't want to be waiting around for the formworker to be forming up the walls of the core before we could progress with further decks. So we basically wanted the core of the building up out of the way so that we could get a good cycle going on our decks. And it worked really well for us on the project. We were able to get sort of 6-7 day turnarounds on the jump form walls, and probably around a 14-day turnaround on the decks, which is pretty good. So you can see it in action up the building there. Basically, the way it works is, in behind those screens, the walls are rolled back and jumped up. Once they're jumped up, there's little platforms that are rolled down so you can have access inside. I think I've actually got an image there. So that's the platforms rolled back so you've got access. You then complete the reinforcing. Everyone's out of there, roll the shutters back in, complete the concrete pour, go through the same process again. Roll it back, jump it, set up the access, Rio, concrete, do it again. So that worked really well for us and enabled us to progress really quickly up through the structure. One of the other main challenges that I just wanted to speak about in terms of the structure was these big X columns, which are supporting the knobby structure. So when we were looking at these, we had really quite a few questions to run through. And it's interesting, Lyons, who's the architects that are working with EJE on the project, they've also come up with some similar designs for a hospital down in Tasmania. So we had the guys from down there phoning us up the other day asking us how the hell to do it. So first of all, we had to understand, where are we going to get these columns? So it's not like you ring up Bunnings or you pop down the hardware and pick up some big bits of steel like this. We contacted One Steel and a lot of fabricators within Australia. We couldn't actually find anyone that was able to make these columns in Australia. We had a few supplier or manufacturers through One Steel that proposed to take a big steel plate and roll it in 3 metre sections and then weld each of those 3 metre sections together up to our full 26 metres. But they couldn't guarantee the ovality on the roll. So obviously you then end up with a sort of ugly bit of bamboo. But what we were able to find in Australia was some high pressure gas pipes over in WA. They're actually stored, and a couple of them in New South Wales as well. They were fabricated in South Korea for high pressure gas lines. So they were pretty perfect for what we wanted. We then had to think about, okay, how are we going to get the reinforcing inside? So you can see on the far right the big reinforcement cages that we had to get in. We had to think about how we were going to safely lift and prop those, because you probably know, but structural steel doesn't have great properties in terms of fire protection. So because it's supporting occupied space above, it needs to be fire rated. If you're not going to clad those in some sort of fire retardant material, we needed that concrete core through the middle of the column to effectively provide that fire rating. So we had to have the reinforcement coming down through the column, but also tying into our footing structure and tying into the slab structure over. So we had to get the reinforcing inside those columns, hanging out of each end, then be able to safely transport them to site, which was fun. We then also had to think about how we're going to fill them with concrete. When you're dealing with such large height columns over 26 metres, there's a risk of, if you're just placing the concrete from above, that you won't ever get the air out of the columns, and so you'll end up with significant voids inside those columns. So what we actually had to do was we had to get a high flow grout and pump the concrete up from below. That was done through our concrete supply company using two different pumps. They needed to be pumped simultaneously. The engineers were worried that if they were pumped individually, they'd end up moving around too much. So it's quite a bit of coordination and planning that went into that, obviously. And that was all completed once we had them erected and braced off into place. And obviously from here, gave us good opportunity then to prep up and to lift the mega structure, which was levels 5 through to level 7 as a complete box, which was fabricated down on the ground. Which you haven't seen the video, I think it might be on the uni website or maybe on YouTube as well. Be worth having a look at instruction images, okay, check those out. So the last complexity that I wanted to talk to you about is our facade. The facade on new space, as some of you would know or appreciate, is a very complicated thing. There's an incredible number of elements on the facade. You've got the main glass panels that you can see there. You've got the back pans, which are the smaller panels that sit in front of the slabs. You've also got some pop-out pods, about 2.5 tonne of steel and glass hanging out the side of the building there. You can see, what have we got, 5 of those pods there in the image. We've also got vertical and horizontal fins. We've got the large urban rooms, which you see with the large steel circular columns around the outside. And we've got a wide variety of different linings as well. You see the gold, which is an anodized aluminium. We've also got a king span. We have an Aluca bond, a Vitra bond, and a significant amount of perforated aluminium sheet as well. So it's an incredibly complicated facade. And you mightn't appreciate, but there is a massive difference between a curtain wall system and a window system or a shop front. A curtain wall system, there is an incredible amount of design and detail that needs to go into that system. That system is all prefabricated away from site, it's delivered and it's bolted together on site, whereas a traditional window or shop front type arrangement, you've got a lot more play because a lot of the actual fabrication installation is done on site in the openings or between levels as the space is available. So the design process that we've had to go through for this facade has been pretty exhaustive. In terms of the detail, there is a ridiculous amount of shop drawings that make up our facade. You see there, that's sort of generally picking up the similar elevation to what you saw in the photo with the panels, the back pans and the pods. We've also got a heap of detail drawings which focus in on things like our stack joint. We've got the fins that need to be detailed, the connection of those fins. The process we had to go through with all that that system, which is, it is actually a bespoke system that's been designed specifically for this project, so it's a new system. It's based on an existing system, but it's had to be modified to suit our structure and our spacings and our spans. So part of that process is we implemented some testing over in Dubai where the panels were fabricated. So you see there's a full 3 bay of panels. There's actually a return on that as well, which was built and manufactured and assembled over in Dubai so that we could then physically test those panels to see how that new system would perform. And that's what you see on the right, is the scissor lift there basically encasing that those panels, where they're effectively sprayed with water and air pressure is applied to them as well to see how they perform in terms of keeping water out and maintaining the air pressure within the building as well. And the process that we went through for that actually identified some areas where we need to do some redesign. So some of the rubber gaskets that provided the waterproofing in the facade were modified, and we also had to modify some of the aluminium extrusions on some of the corner details to improve the waterproofing on those as well. And that's just that's a bit of a markup of the process where we were working closely with our subcontractors and with our consultant team to make sure that we captured some of those issues that were identified through that testing regime that we went through. So slowly but surely we are overcoming the challenges of the build in terms of where we're at the moment. The substructure is obviously complete. We're pretty close to working our way through the structure. The facade is well progressed, which is good. And now we start to focus on some additional challenges around some of the structural steel elements of the project, which are just starting to be installed. You may have seen those going on, some of the urban rooms, and we'll be progressing the main roof structure of the podium levels in the coming weeks. And we start to look at internal finishes and services fit out, which is pretty significant for the building as well when you see some of the technology that's going inside. So that was it from me. A bit of a whirlwind tour through some of the complexities. But just to reinforce, it will be a real state-of-the-art facility when it's completed.